everybody, live on the Yankee Baseball Network, WPIX Sports presents its 40th season of New York Yankee Baseball.
Welcome to Arlington Stadium in Arlington, Texas. Tonight, the New York Yankees take on the Texas Rangers. Hi, everybody. Welcome to New York Yankee Baseball. I'm Phil Rizzuto, along with Tom Seaver, George Grant later on. And we hope you enjoyed the Billy Martin special, because I know you're going to enjoy this Texas matchup tonight, Thomas.
Well, it's good. We have Andy Hawkins going for the Yankees tonight against Nolan Ryan. And you look at Nolan Ryan's numbers over his career, and you really get something of legendary proportions. He's already 2-0 this season, beat the Yankees and Andy Hawkins at the stadium earlier in the season. He's going after win number 292. Now, this is a guy that in his career already, the major league strikeout record forever, he's over 5,000 strikeouts.
Unbelievable, I'd say. And he beat the Yankees when he didn't have good stuff last time.
That's one of the marks of a good pitcher. And Nolan Ryan in the second half of his career has become a good pitcher, not just a thrower. He's learned how to win with not having his best stuff on the mound. And that is the mark of a good pitcher.
It certainly is. Well, I guess you're wondering why I got this hat on. Seaver was supposed to ask me why I had it on, but I'll tell you. The Yankees have gone 7 games without a home run. That's the longest they've gone without a home run since 1918. And Home Run Baker wore this hat, not this identical hat, but a hat just like it. And he hit the home run to break their spell. They had gone 9 games without a home run. So maybe we'll erase the jinx tonight. See you in a little while.
Hi, hello, and welcome back to Arlington Stadium in Arlington, Texas. George Grant along with Tom Seaver and Phil Rizzuto. A couple of hours ago, people were wondering here in Arlington, Texas, whether we even had a chance of playing baseball. A torrential downpour came late this morning and continued through the early afternoon hours, but the grounds crew here has done a tremendous job, Tom Seaver, to try to get this field ready and enable us to play some baseball tonight.
Well, George, it was what you really call a gully washer. It was pouring here most of the day. It let up around 3 or 4 o'clock this afternoon, as predicted by the local weatherman. But I mean, it was really raining heavily. It'll be heavy in the outfield for the outfielders. A lot of standing water around, so we might see some people taking extra bases tonight on the outfielders. We'll get a quick look at the lineup for the New York Yankees and the men that they'll send after Nolan Ryan, who is just now heading for the mound here in Arlington, Texas. Steve Sachs leads it off and plays second base. Number 2 hitter, Alvaro Espinoza at shortstop. Number 3 hitter, Don Mattingly at first base. The cleanup hitter is Mel Hall. He's in left field tonight. The DH, Dave Winfield, hits in the number 5 spot. Jesse Barfield hits 6th. He plays right field. Roberto Kelly in center hits 7th. Rick Cerrone will do the catching tonight. He bats 8th, and Randy Velarde is at third base again in the place of Mike Flowers, and he bats in the ninth position. And they will be taking a look at Nolan Ryan, going for his 292nd win here tonight of his fabulous career. One phenomenal athlete, George.
Whenever number 34 goes on the mound, the people come out to watch here in Arlington, Texas. And that was one of the reasons why everyone expected this game to at least get underway tonight, because when Ryan pitches, they average 3,000 to 4,000 more per game than when anybody else throws. And for good reason, Tom. All you have to do is look at the record book and see why.
Well, this franchise went over the 2 million mark last year in the 1989 season for the first time in their history. And Nolan Ryan, the main reason. This is not a ball club that had a good year on the field last year. They had high expectations. They finished 4th. But Nolan's draw and what he does on the mound gets people into the ballpark. He is a fabulous athlete with a great work ethic, a great God-given ability. And we'll expand on that as we go through the game. He is one of the hardest workers in the game of baseball, and at his age, he knows what he has to do to be able to perform his job, and he does it very well.
Steve Sachs will step in to lead off for the Yankees. Sachs at 276 on the year with no doubles, no home runs, and 1 run batted in. He hit 285 against left-handers last year, and of course he knows Ryan from both leagues now. Hit high to center field. Gary Pettis back drifting in the soggy turf at Arlington Stadium, and there's one down. Gary Pettis, Gold Glover perennially, last night made the first error for him in the last 90 games, and you can see why. He was charging a ground ball, slipped, it went by him all the way to the warning track, and he was charged with an error. Pettis today shook it off, said, hey, it can happen to anybody, but the way the turf was yesterday and the way it is today could very well affect anything that's hit to the outfield, Tom.
Well, I think if you hit balls that are hit in the gaps or hit to the sides of the outfielders, that this ball's going to check up very quickly. And outfielders are going to have to go at it tentatively because of the probability of slipping. I would expect the base runners, if they got a chance to get an extra base, they've got to go, especially the way the field conditions are tonight.
They had the squeegees out for about 3 hours before game time. And there's Espinosa, one ball and one strike. Espy at 160 on the year, but 5 for 18 in the last six games.
There's the changeup, and Espy way out in front of it. The outfield defense for Espinosa swung way around to the right.
1-1 pitch, you win. 1-2.
I mentioned that on the off-speed pitch because sometimes when you play your defense in certain ways, you see how Pettis is way around in right center. The pitcher, if he gives a hitter to pitch something hit off-speed that he can pull the ball, it really crosses up the defense.
That's high, 2-2, setting the defense. Incaviglia in left, Pettis in center, Sierra in right, in the infield, Bouchel at third. Houston is the shortstop, Franco at second, Palmeiro at first, Gino Petralli behind the plate. Catching that man, the man who owns over 40 major league records, Nolan Ryan. And there's strikeout number one on this evening as Espinosa goes down, and there are two away as Don Mattingly comes to the plate.
Fastball up and out of the strike zone, one of the very, very difficult pitches to lay off. It looks good, but you just don't get to it. Nolan Ryan's ball very live from the letters up. That ball out of the strike zone, but you don't have much time to make a decision whether you're going to swing or not.
Mattingly at 407, number two in the American League, and uncharacteristically for him is off to a great start. He's averaged 275 in the month of April and well over 300 for the rest of the year. This year, he's red hot at 400. Hit hard to center field, but Pettis has plenty of room. Three up, three down for the Yankees in the top of the first. We'll go to the bottom of the first inning as Andy Hawkins will take the mound for the New York Yankees. The score at the end of a half inning in Arlington, Texas, the Yankees nothing, the Rangers coming to bat.
Bottom of the first inning here at Arlington Stadium in Arlington, Texas, in the lineup for the Texas Rangers, managed by Bobby Ballantyne. Gary Pettis, the center fielder, leads it off. Rafael Palmeiro is the second hitter, playing first base. Julio Franco is the second baseman and hits third. Ruben Sierra, the right fielder, bats cleanup. The DH in the number five spot tonight, Harold Baines. Hitting sixth, the left fielder, Pete Incaviglia. Hitting seventh, the catcher, Gino Petralli. Steve Buschel plays third and hits eighth, and the number 900, Jeff Huson, is the shortstop, and they will be taking their swings against Andy Hawkins, who had the matchup with Nolan Ryan in New York and ended up on the short end of an 8-4 loss for the Yankees.
Gary Pettis steps in against Andy Hawkins, taking strike one. The umpires today, Rocky Rose behind the plate, Dan Morrison's at first, Larry Barnett, the crew chief, is at second, and Greg Kosk is over at third base. The one strike pitch, top down to Mattingly. It was foul at the plate. Now they say he's out. Pettis was arguing that it was foul at the plate, and Rocky Road jumped out in front and asked for help from first base umpire Dan Morrison. Morrison said fair ball, and there's one down.
Pettis never left home plate. I don't know why. There's no reason for him not to leave. The ball was clearly fair all the way. Don Mattingly looking for Pettis and wondering what was going on to see whether it hit off his foot or not. No, it hits off the dirt and bounces into fair territory, fair ball.
It was an attempt at an Academy Award performance.
That's right.
Gary's part.
He knew he wasn't going to beat it out.
Palmeiro up now. Rafael off to his usual hot start at 394, number five in the American League. Last year he started at 361 until the last week in May, and then from there on hit 235. The Rangers hope he can avoid that in 1990, and they need his number two slot in the order to be productive.
Some of the people think that it was the Palmeiro trying to hit home runs that really caused the slump in the average.
Two balls and one strike.
He's not a home run hitter. He's got to use the whole ballpark. Contact, hit the ball to left field, hit the ball in the gaps. Perfect number two hitter if he can do that. Good contact hitter. This is a big ballpark, and the wind will play tricks with the ball. 330 down the line, 380 in the alleys, 400 to straightaway center field.
Did you like to pitch here?
I just didn't like the stadium, George. I like the field. The field was a good field to pitch on. It was always in very good shape, very well manicured. But this was a double-A stadium at one time, and they have turned it into a major league stadium, or supposedly a major league stadium. Talking to George Bush Jr., who is one of the owners of the Rangers, they are planning on building a new stadium for this ball club.
He just saw one of the things that most believe Andy Hawkins has to do, and that's pitch effectively inside. He throws a fastball and a bit of a cut fastball along with a slider and a changeup, but he's got to push these people off the plate, Tom, to be successful. Hit hard, Mattingly will take it himself, and there's two down. No better place to go with it than to number 23, who's a five straight gold glover.
Mattingly makes both first two outs in this ball game, both of them unassisted. Exactly right about Andy Hawkins, George. You have to pitch inside. I have always been an advocate of pitching inside. You must make the hitters play it honest. You may want to get people out on the outside part of the plate, but you have to pitch them inside. It doesn't mean you have to throw strikes inside. You can throw in off the plate from the edge of the plate toward the hitter.
Julio Franco steps in at 175, and he just has not been able to get grooved as yet. You know, before the season started, the first week of spring training, he experienced some chest pains, went home, saw the doctor. Doctor gave him a clean bill of health, but he really has not been his normal active self in the clubhouse or, for that matter, on the base paths. They need his bat. And when this lineup with Palmeiro, Franco, Sierra, and Baines is clicking, and then Incavilla following it up, it is one of the toughest lineups to get through in the American League. 1-1 pitch.
Well, you got to know he's going to hit, too. He's hit 300 4 years in a row. Julio Franco is an established, good offensive player. Great big long swing, but he makes very good contact. Will supply some power. A heady base runner will steal a base when you need it.
Hit hard, but foul down the right field line.
Well, you get that ball up there in that area. Julio Franco's going to hit it hard.
Yeah, the book on him is
slider.
Try to get it up and in on him, but somehow he manages to hit inside pitches consistently in spite of the way he holds the bat, in spite of his stance. He's one strong athlete.
Strong hands, extremely strong hands. Look how far that bat has to travel.
1-2 pitch. Espinosa, Mattingly, and Franco is retired. So at the end of one at Arlington, Texas, Espinosa puts the capper on it for the Yankees. The score, the Yankees nothing. The Texas Rangers nothing. Due up, Mel Hall, Dave Winfield, and Jesse Barfield for the Yankees. This copyright telecast is presented by authority of the New York Yankees and WPIX and is intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the New York Yankees is prohibited. Mel Hall, Dave Winfield, Jesse Barfield due up against Nolan Ryan here in the top of the second inning. No score at Arlington if you're just joining us. High ball one. Heavy rainfall around Arlington today. Partly cloudy skies now. There still are some showers in the area, but it is hoped they'll be able to get this one in. You know they wanted to. It was a heavy sell, plus Nolan Ryan on the mound and the Yankees in town. 1-1 to Hall. Whenever the Yankees come to town, it's big numbers at the gate here at Arlington. And big numbers when 34 pitches, too, Tom.
Hitters talk about how do you go after Nolan Ryan? What's the theory of hitting against him? Some hitters look in a certain area. Some hitters will just look for one pitch. Well, that fastball right by him. Like many power pitchers, you've got to get him earlier. You're never going to get him. A lot of things that hitters talk about facing a Nolan Ryan, and this is a good look at the fastball. Mel Holloway is a good fastball hitter on that part of the plate. He's at no chance. The hitters that Nolan Ryan will eat up are the hitters that go to the plate and try to hit both pitches. Nolan has a great curveball. He has a super fastball. You better pick one pitch to hit, and that's it.
1-2 pitch, pop back and out of play. He's developed a change in the last couple of years, and you know, the rumors have followed in the National League and in the American League that he scuffs up the ball. Do you believe that?
I don't think Nolan has to scuff up the ball.
Right.
He may have learned some of that from Mike Scott down in Houston. Scott has been accused of that on numerous occasions.
1-2 to Hall. You know, it's kind of a difficult and delicate situation to deal with, though, if you're the opposition, because if you're Nolan Ryan and you own 40 some odd records and somebody comes out and says check the ball, number one, it's sour grapes, and number two, if he still comes back and blows you away with a fastball anyways, it doesn't make much difference. 2-2 pitch, hot back and out of play.
Another thing about that, George, talking about pitchers, whether they scuff the ball or whether they throw the spitball, a lot of times hitters and an opposing team can be their own worst enemy. They say check the ball, check the ball. One of the things that Gaylord Perry, who was always accused of throwing a spitball, he would have everybody go up there looking for the spitball, being so obsessed with the spitball they'd forget about hitting.
2 balls, 2 strikes. Full count to Mel Hall, who's hitting at 095, and after a red hot spring has just had trouble getting out of the gate. He's 2 for his last 21. Now, the other side of it too, Tom, is that most staffs have somebody that's questionable, and if you try to blow the whistle on the opposition, then that means it's fair game to blow the whistle on you too. So if you've got somebody on your staff that may be questionable the way they deliver a pitch now and then, you know they're going to come right back at you. Like, let sleeping dogs lie, maybe. 3-2 pitch to Hall. Hop back and near the dugout, it'll reach the seats again.
There's a great story about, it was a general manager that called into the dugout to the manager on the field and said, listen, get those umpires, that opposing pitchers throwing spitballs and everything. And the manager on the phone to the general manager said, just be quiet, what do you think my pitcher is doing?
Anybody that pitches for any length of time learns a lot of tricks, some legal, some illegal. It's a question of what you want to use when the bell rings. Full count to Hall with Winfield on deck, followed by Barfield. Hit hard right field. Back goes Sierra. He won't get this one. It's gone. Mel Hall hits the Yankees' first home run of 1990. It's a bullet off Nolan Ryan. And the home run drought is over. And fans, you know what happens every time a Yankee hits a home run. Mel Hall, this bud dries for you. So Scooter wore the hat tonight, and it paid off, Tom, because Mel Hall, who last year led the Yankees with 16 home runs against right-hand pitchers, just hammers this one.
The fastball, he got it down. Nolan was going after Mel Hall up in the strike zone, and he got it down where Mel could get at it. Remember the pitch that Alvaro Espinosa struck out on, the one up out of the strike zone, just at the top, that one right down about mid-thigh, and that's right in golden territory for Mel Hall. He crushed that ball.
High ball one to Winfield. Dave at 278 on the year with 2 doubles and 2 runs batted in. He started 4 games as the DH and 2 in left field. He's DHing tonight. Bucky Dent did not want to take a chance with the slippery footing out in left field to put him out there.
After the home run, a fastball up in the strike zone, and there Winfield thinking fastball inside way out in front of the breaking ball.
1 ball, 1 strike. Taking ball outside. You know, Bucky Dent before the game tonight said he wasn't worried about the Yankees' lack of home runs, but he was worried that everybody else was. Every reporter that came into the locker room wanted to know why the Yankees weren't hitting home runs. He said, look, as long as we keep hitting the ball the way we are, and even in the loss against Cleveland yesterday, they hit a good dozen shots that were right at somebody. In fact, John McNamara after the game said, when he was asked about the Yankees' lack of home run power, he said, if I was hitting the ball the way they were hitting the ball against us tonight, I'd just leave them alone. They'll start falling in. Foul back by Winfield, and it's another 3-2 count. So Ryan's throwing a lot of pitches in the first two innings, Tom.
Nolan will throw a lot of pitches, and anybody that strikes out as many as he does, anybody that walks as many as Nolan does, is certainly going to throw a lot of pitches. But he has, sometimes I have calculated up some of the pitches he has thrown in games. I mean, he is a phenomenal athlete in the sense that he can throw 175, 190 pitches. Winfield strikes out. I don't know if Nolan could do that anymore, but I sat in a bullpen one day when I was that active player and watching a game, and there was a, they were flashing things on the scoreboard about how many Nolan Ryan had struck out. He was, I think it was Detroit. It was a big 18 strikeout game for him or whatever, and they also said he had walked 11 or something. We were trying to compute how many pitches he has thrown or must have thrown as a minimum in a game, and we got over 200. And it doesn't seem to faze him.
Dave Winfield, his second victim this evening. Jesse Barfield, there's strike one. He has struck out more than anyone in history. He's walked more, and obviously he's thrown more pitches than anybody in history, probably.
Well, a little bit of education about pitching there. He got to Mel Hall 3-2 and went after him with four straight fastballs. Got one down, and Mel hits it out. He got 3-2 to Dave Winfield and went with the off-speed pitch.
0-1 to Barfield, hit hard down the line. Will it stay fair? It's a fair ball, and Barfield will coast into second. Now it's foul. Now they call it foul. They took a first look at it, and then Greg Koss signaled it was just foul. It's a part of the ballpark where, especially with the lights and at nighttime, right about now, it's a difficult place to see. And as Koss turned around and went to the corner, he waited, then raised the hands on a foul ball. So Barfield hits it hard, gets around on it, but he's left with an 0-2 count.
Most of the time they raise their hands and then point them into foul territory. Greg looked like he just raised his hands up as if to say he was indecisive about what the call was. The ball was clearly foul.
There are ballparks, and Yankee Stadium is that way too in the corner. Unless you get a clear view from another side, you can't see deep into the corner. One ball, two strikes to Barfield. Jesse checks in at 278 with two doubles and a triple and one run batted in. After a slow start, he's 4-for-11 in his last three games and has hit the ball hard the last couple of days. Ryan gets him. Strikeout number three for Nolan. And there are two down here in the second inning.
Looked like another off-speed pitch. Could have been a changeup. Barfield swings right through it. The amazing thing about a Nolan Ryan is that he gives up the home run to Hall on a 3-2 pitch, and then the off-speed that strikes out Winfield, another off-speed that strikes out Barfield. You would think in the first couple of innings that you'd be getting the fastball all the time early, but Nolan might not start throwing his hardest until he gets into the fourth or fifth inning. And these same hitters might come up in the fifth, sixth, seventh, or eighth inning, and it'll be the reverse. He'll get to 3-2, and then he'll go after him with heat. That's when he'll get loose and really be able to pop the ball.
Roberto Kelly checks in at 333. The ball, one pitch. One.
Nolan has a great big left leg kick. That front leg that comes up, he brings that right up into his chest. Very deliberately, that gives his arm time to get into throwing position. Much like the backswing in golf, everything has to be in set position before you take the club to the ball. That's what the stretch does and the windup does for a pitcher.
Two balls, two strikes, and You both come from the same school that the leg drive is so important to successful and proper form in pitching.
Well, Nolan, very strong from the waist down. You can see how that left knee gets up there almost as, right up into his chin. And that is an exaggerated lift. And it's something that he does consciously, and it buys time to get all the body parts in the right position.
2-2 to Kelly. Foul back. Was one of your trademarks was that scuff of dirt on your knee after your follow through as you got down and drove towards the plate. Did you ever notice you were doing it when you were young, or did it just kind of develop little by little?
Oh, it just kind of developed and became something that the press talked about, wrote about a lot. A lot of times I'd come out of the bullpen and I'd just pick up a bunch of dirt and mud and rub it on my knee. Especially on days when I didn't feel like I was throwing very well, you know.
They want dirt, they'll get dirt.
You talked earlier about all the little tricks of the trade that might happen. All the little psychological tricks that go on as well.
Two balls, two strikes, Ryan to Kelly. He waits on it, punches it to the right side. It's fouling out of play. Good job of waiting here, Tom.
Well, Roberto probably looking for the fastball and sees the curve and just enough to fight it off. He's very happy just to get a piece of that ball and not strike out.
All back again.
The Yanks are having good cuts at Nolan's fastball.
Ryan did not have his best stuff in his 8-4 victory over the Yankees at Yankee Stadium. And when the game was over, they felt they could have beaten him on that day, and it doesn't appear, at least this early, that he has his best stuff tonight either. Good enough to get Roberto, and Kelly goes down, as do Barfield and Winfield, but Mel Hall's home run gives the Yankees a lead. The score after an inning and a half, the Yankees won, the Rangers nothing. Now let's pause for station identification. Arlington, Texas, Andy Hawkins set to face Sierra, Baines, and Incavilla. Here in the bottom of the second inning, the Yankees on Mel Hall's home run after an outstanding at bat. He fouled four or five pitches off, a 3-2 count, and then rifled a home run just over the 360 mark in right field. Ruben Sierra, in his tracks, knew it was gone from the moment it hit the bat. Sierra steps in at 275. In a slump also at 3-for-20 in his last four games. During the series in New York, and that's called strike one, the Yankees were able to pretty well control the center of this Texas order. Foul down the left field line. It'll be out of play, and Sierra is 0-2.
They fed Ruben Sierra a good diet of off-speed stuff when the Yanks and the Rangers played the series up in New York. Tried to get him out in front. There's a big leg kick. Timing very important to Ruben Sierra. Shortened spring may have hurt him as far as getting on track.
And Sierra goes nibbling for that one on the outside corner and misses. It's the first strikeout for Andy Hawkins. That was funny when we were in New York, Tom, and on the field before the game, before the first game, you went up to Rube and Bobby Valentine came by and said, did you ever face this guy? That was an interesting discussion the two of you had.
Yes, I did face Ruben Sierra when he was a rookie. And you would ask me that, wouldn't you? Especially for the White Sox. And he, I said, here's this young kid. He won't hit this little slider all running at his, about his belt buckle. Boy, and he rocketed that pitch into the seats at Comiskey Park. Holy mackerel, who is this kid?
And then how'd you pitch him after that?
Carefully.
One ball, one strike to Errol Baines. You know, it was the way he said it, though, was it, the look on his face. He was almost shy about it and timid about it.
He wasn't when he was swinging the bat.
No, no. Outstanding young man. Two balls, one strike. Baines wearing his familiar number 3, the number, of course, he wore with the White Sox when he came over last year. Rafael Palmeiro was wearing three. This year, Palmeiro switched to 25 to allow Baines to wear three again. Holds off on this one, ball four, and Baines is on. That's the first walk issued by Hawkins, and that'll bring up Incaviglia. Inky has had Hawkins' number. He's 6-for-11 with two home runs against Andy Hawkins in his career, so Hawkins knows he has to pitch him carefully. In the bottom of the second, the Yankees lead it 1-0 as Baines leads off first. There's a strike. Baines at one time had good speed, but he's had so much difficulty with the knees that the Yankees will give Mattingly the chance to play behind him and give him a little room because they do not expect him to go. Incaviglia, of course, one of a rare breed, one of six position players to go directly to the majors. John Olerud from Toronto, another one who's in the, of course, lineup this year with the Blue Jays. One ball, one strike. Inside, off the edge of the bat, and it's strike two, 1-2. Of course, Dave Winfield is one of those. Brian Milner, Dave Roberts, Bob Horner, and a host of pitchers, too. Set all kinds of home run records at Oklahoma State. Very fine baseball program. One ball, two strikes. Baines off first. And Incaviglia goes down swinging. For Incaviglia, his 10th, 11th strikeout of the year. He's on a pace to be where he usually is, around 150 or 160 strikeouts a year.
In his rookie year in 86, George, he struck out 185 times. His strikeouts have gone down, but that may be the only reason for that is that his playing time has gone down. If they could get him to put the ball in play a lot more, that would help this, the bottom half of this Ranger lineup.
Two outs, Baines on first, Petrali to the plate. Gino's at 190, but last week got three of his season total of four hits against the Yankees. Into short left field. No one will get this one. Baines round second, holds, and Hall will run it in. So Petrali continues to enjoy Yankee pitching. Didn't hit it hard, but put it in the right place.
A little cut fastball or a slider on the inside part of the plate. It really sawed him off. When Petrali got to first base, he was just sitting there shaking his fingers. He really hurt his hands on it, not getting good wood on the ball, but there was no chance for Mel Hall or Alvaro Espinosa to run that ball down. Little blue pits, they'll kill you. But you can't worry about it if you make good pitches, and Andy Hawkins did make a good pitch, but gave up the base hit.
Two on, two out, Bouchel at 240 on the year, but 5 of 13 in his last four games. He started to swing the hot bat. So there's two on and two out. Baines at second. Petrali over at first. And we'll continually remind you that it's like starting in quicksand in the outfield tonight. There was standing water over much of the outfield for most of the afternoon. They squeegeed it off, but it's still very wet. Just misses inside, one ball and one strike.
You were talking earlier, George, about the middle of this Texas Ranger lineup. Palmeiro, Franco, Sierra, Harold Baines. Two guys in the bottom part of this lineup that are going to have to hit if the Rangers are going to compete in this American League West. Incaviglia, and this is the other one, Steve Buschel. They need some production from him. Look at the other clubs around Oakland, California, Kansas City, Minnesota. This is a tough division. And you're going to have production throughout your lineup, not just in the middle four.
He had 16 home runs a year ago, but 12 of them were solo shots. Did not hit well with runners in scoring position. The sacks. Tricky hop over to Espinosa, and that retires the side. So Bouchel stays to form, and even though the Rangers get two on, Hawkins gets out of trouble and will go to the third inning. At Arlington Stadium, Cerrone, Velarde, and Sachs do up. The Yankees lead the Rangers 1-0. Reminder, on May the 3rd, the Yankees play the Cleveland Indians at 1 o'clock at Yankee Stadium. That's a makeup game that does not appear on your schedule. Citibank Yankee Cap weekend, Saturday and Sunday, the 28th and 29th against the Angels. And World Champion A's make their first stadium appearance, April 30th, May 1st and 2nd. Some Yankee games on your schedule as Rick Cerrone steps in. Cerrone, Velarde, and Sachs do up against Ryan, who already has four strikeouts but trails the Yankees 1-0. And Rick Cerrone said before the game, I don't have many claims to fame, but at least I'm hitting 375 against Ryan for my career.
He got that out in the first paragraph.
That's
too,
it.
Didn't he?
Hi, good morning. I'm hitting 375 against Ryan. One ball, one strike. Cerrone at 286 on the year with a double and one run batted in. Hit hard to left field and back. Incavilla to the warning track. That's gone. Rick Cerrone made good on the statistics. They said 375. And the Seton Hall product hammers Ryan deep to left center field. And the Yankees have a 2-0 lead. And you know what happens every time a Yankee hits a home run. Rick Cerrone, this bud dries for you. Number 11 hops right on this one, Tom.
Good piece of hitting by Cerrone. Nolan has been using a lot of off-speed pitches. The breaking ball prior to that pitch, that was a changeup that he hit out. And he was able to keep his hands back and just get it into the air. Here you see Nolan pulling the string, throwing the changeup. See how the ball dies at the end, but it dies right back to the middle of the plate. Cerrone got it up in the air here in Texas, and ball carried over that 380 mark.
Velarde hits it a long way down the left field line, but foul. Velarde's 0-for-4 on the year. He came up at the end of last year, hit 340, 34 for 100, and really thought that he had earned the third base job. And when he showed up for spring training this year, Mike Blowers had the third base job. He's getting a chance now that Blowers has had trouble at the plate to play a little, and quietly and in a determined fashion, he's trying to make his point that he can play on an everyday basis. 2-1 pitch. He's played second, he's played short, a very versatile athlete. Some believe his best position is as a utility infielder. But Mike Blowers has left the door open for him to move in.
One of the question marks that we've talked about, George, too, is third base, one of the big question marks for the Yanks this year. Well, the catching is a question mark. Dave Winfield's back is a question mark. And, of course, the starting pitching.
3-2 pitch to Velarde. Ball four, and Ryan walks his first of the night.
Pretty upset. That's a no-no walking the number nine hitter. Nolan, of course, we talked about him, will throw a lot of pitches. He goes to 3-2. Looks almost on some pitches as if he's short arming the ball. Short arming, I mean, he's dropping his elbow just slightly and not getting good extension with his throwing arm. That could be a factor of shortened spring training.
Sign of fatigue?
No, not really fatigue. It's his third start of the season and may not have been able to stretch it out enough in spring training. It's different throwing on the side than it is so going into a ball game and throwing against hitters. It's a totally different situation. One of the best ways, the best way for a pitcher to condition himself is by pitching and pitching in ball games. That's really the best work day that you have, is being on that mound and throwing to live hitting.
2-0 to Steve Sachs. Bouchel was in on the grass at third. Velarde off first with a 2-0 count. Sachs steps out, looks down at Joe Sparks at third. The Yankees intend on trying to move runners and do some things this year to manufacture runs. Velarde bluffs, and there's strike one.
show you a little bit about how Nolan Ryan is not real happy the way he's throwing. He falls behind 2-0, and then there's the changeup again. You see Joe Sparks going through the signs. And a pitcher can tell you what he wants to work with. If you're a hitter, you sit there and watch him. He can tell you what he's confident in.
Up the middle, Houston, DeFranco for one, and that's all they'll get. 6-4 on the force play at second. And that'll bring up Espinosa. Jeff Houston, who continues to impress the Rangers with the way he plays shortstop. Not a difficult play, but many feel that he is the best shortstop on this team right now. And Velarde went right after Franco.
Not a difficult play. That's the kind of play that you want your shortstop to make. The one thing about your shortstop, you want him to make all the regular routine plays. Don't boot the easy ones. Make the plays you're supposed to make. That's one thing that Espinosa proved last year, that he could make the routine play. That's why he became such a popular individual within the Yankee organization. He made all the routine plays, and then he expanded and went on and showed all the other things that he could do.
And one of the things he did do last year was lead the Yankees with 23 sacrifice bunts. He squared around, and obviously the wheels turn now as the Rangers want to see if Sax is going to go. The Yankees want to see how the Rangers are going to play it. The one ball pitch from Ryan to Espinosa. Espy calls time. Now you say 23 sacrifice bunts, and he did it from all over the order. He hit second, seventh, eighth, ninth. In fact, in the number two position where he is tonight, he hit 336 last year, and that, you mentioned things that surprised. That was probably the most pleasing of all the surprises. Sacks not going. With strike one.
He hits so high in that, such a high average in that position one, because you get Steve Sacks on in front of you. You're going to see a lot of fastballs. Espinosa is a fastball hitter. Also hitting in front of Don Mattingly. You don't want to walk in Espinosa. You want to make sure that he's going to get on. He hits his way on. Another area for him to get a lot of fastballs. Yankees have got to do something here. They have their two individuals that are best at creating something, making something happen. Sax on first, Espinosa at the plate. That's why Espy is in this number two spot, to do something to help Sax get to second base. Plus, the Rangers have had a lot of difficulty throwing runners out, too, George. 9 stolen bases against the ball club this year. They've only thrown 2 runners out.
A lot of that the product of Huff's knuckleball, Ryan's big kick, and Bobby Witt's wildness. Almost got him. Sacks just did get the hand back in. He looks like he's ready to go.
Sacks was fudging over there, almost leaning his weight towards second base, and Nolan giving him the good move. He tried to decoy him and give him the lazy move over there, saving the best move for when he thought he had a good chance of picking him off, and just about got him.
Mattingly on deck, 1-1 to Espinosa. Sacks not going. Not since Snuffy Sternweiss in 44 and Bobby Richardson in 62 has anyone had 23 sacrifice bunts in 1 year for the Yankees. There goes Sacks. Swung on and missed. The throw. They get him. All the statistics show that if you can keep somebody close, your chances of throwing them out are a lot better at second base. And the fans here, some of them standing, and it's somewhat of a Bronx cheer because they don't throw many out.
Didn't have a very good pitch to throw, work on Sacks either, an off-speed pitch, and Espinosa with a big swing out in front of him. The ball beat him. The ball beat Sacks to the bag, and I think that's why second base umpire Larry Barnett called him out.
And with Mattingly on deck, the runner is erased, and then Espinosa strikes out. So Mattingly will lead off come next inning. We'll go to the bottom of the third inning at Arlington. The Yankees, on home runs by Cerrone and Hall, lead the Texas Rangers 2-0. Back at Arlington, The Rangers knew what the Yankees were going to do, and Tom, maybe the Yankees waited a little too long to do what they wanted to try.
They're waiting for the count 2-1 before they put anything on. The question is whether Franco got the tag on Steve Sax. Sax said no, but it looks like Franco just did touch him. Bucky Dent waiting until the count got two balls and a strike. Even on the changeup, they're able to throw Sax out.
Houston, Pettis, and Palmeiro due up for the Rangers. It's one ball and one strike to Houston, who is a fine overall athlete. He was picked up just at the end of spring training. They really didn't get a good chance to look at him. They left him on the roster. Hawkins over. He'll take it himself. And there's one down. People within the organization, in fact, even Joe Sparks, who had a chance to watch him in the International League, feel that Houston is their best shortstop. And from a defensive standpoint, will probably spend more games there than anybody else. That'll bring up Gary Pettis, who bounced to Mattingly unassisted in the first inning. We're in the bottom of the third. The Yankees, two runs, two hits, both home runs. Cerrone to left, Hall to right. The Rangers, no runs and one hit, a single by Petrelli. Fouled off by Pettis. Strike one.
Ouch. Home plate umpire Smarts. Rocky Rowe, boy, he took that one right off the top of that mask. Getting hit by a heavyweight right in the
yellow
forehead. Ouch. That'll make the ears ring.
It's an 0-2 count. On deck is Rafael Palmeiro. That man could throw the leather at you. A gold glover in just about any year. Just a question of whether he gets enough games due to injuries. But when he's out there, he can go get them. The plate, it's another story, though. That one gets away from Hawkins.
We talked about Nolan Ryan getting underneath the ball, dropping the elbow a little bit. Andy Hawkins there. I mean, he almost threw that one straight uphill. Hawkins, to be effective, has had to move the ball around in the strike zone. Change speeds in and out, must pitch inside, keep the hitters off the plate, stay ahead in the count.
Sack scoops to Mattingly, and there's two down. Number 23 celebrating his 29th birthday this evening. Usually it accounts for some kind of fireworks in his career. He's a 368 hitter on his birthday. He's always there with a glove. Palmeiro also bounced to Mattingly in the first inning. 0 for 1 at 394 coming into the ball game. Fouled into the Rangers dugout. One thing about Hawkins, he gives you innings. He didn't miss a start last year for the Yankees when he was 15-15 and was their only 200 inning pitcher. And you need at least one. You really like to have two on your staff like that.
The Rangers only had one pitcher with over 200 innings last year, Nolan Ryan. Hawkins can be very good. He can be very bad. That kind of pitcher. But there are days when he is outstanding. And the days that he's outstanding is when he does move the ball around. He'll have a tendency to get underneath the ball and keep the ball up in the strike zone.
Pop back and out of play.
Those are the days that he gets hurt. His shoulder movement gets a little bit lateral. His elbow drops down a little bit, and he almost seems to push the ball into the hitting zone. He loses movement, and he loses location and gets the ball up in the strike zone. If he can stay on top of the ball, drive the ball down through the strike zone, those are the days that he is most effective. He's done that so far today.
1-2 to Palmeiro. 2-2. You know, he fell into the face the number one pitcher syndrome too in 1989, somewhat similar to this year where he goes against Ryan his first two starts. He was the Yankees number one starter, and he went against the best of the other team every time out. Most would say he is a number two, maybe, but probably a number three starter on a strong staff.
He's a good number three starter. Randy Hawkins is a good number three starter.
Full count to Palmeiro. There's ball four.
That's the pitch I'm talking about there. It looked like he got under it and just pushed it up to home plate. Right underneath it. You see the elbow looks like it drops down a little bit, almost as if he shoves it up to home plate. It's a very fine line. And if you don't keep your hand and your elbow up and keep your hand on top of the ball will straighten out and lose location. Pitcher has to feel as if he's driving the ball down through the strike zone.
Julio Franco bounced to short his first time up with Palmeiro on first. He takes strike one.
Big hole on the right side between Mattingly and Saxon. Franco likes to go that way. Julio is a hitter that will use the entire field, and if you overshift and give him too big a hole, any good hitter, if you give him a great big hole, they'll utilize it.
Foul by about 6 feet down the right field line.
You see him going that way. He's shooting for it. Roberto Kelly in center field is quite a ways over toward right center as well. A big gap in left center. There you see the outfield. Roberto almost in line with Steve Sachs, and there's the gap in left center. Now, if you're a hitter and you walk up there, you got to say, well, this pitcher is not going to throw me much off speed stuff because he doesn't expect me to pull the ball to left center. They expect me to hit the ball to right field. So I'm going to get hard stuff, probably hard stuff away.
Do you come back now 0-2 in tight?
Better coming off the plate. We talked about it before. What you talked about right in the first inning, George, is coming. If you're going to get somebody out outside, you got to come inside. Back somebody off the plate.
Two out, 0-2 pitch. Hit hard to center field, but Kelly has a beat on it. And that retires the Rangers in the bottom of the third inning on the Citicorp scoreboard. The score after three innings of play in Arlington, the Yankees 2, the Rangers nothing. When the Yankees come up, we'll go to Mattingly, Hall, and Winfield.
Back at Arlington Stadium, starting the top of the fourth inning, and you see the outfield. It looks like ice petals out there. That is just a reflection of the lights off the water that is standing in the outfield. Torrential rain the earlier part of the day here in Texas, and the possibility of more rain as we go on. Yanks lead this game against the Rangers 2-0. A couple of home runs, one by Mel Hall and one by Rick Cerrone. Both of them against Nolan Ryan. Nolan going after win 292 here tonight. It'll be Mattingly, Hall, and Winfield for New York here in the fourth inning. Winfield, a fly ball to center, his first time up. That fouled straight back. In case you're wondering where the scooter is gone, I have a new partner, broadcasting partner. George Bush Jr., managing general partner and one of the owners of the Texas Rangers. George, welcome.
Tom, good to see you again.
In case that name sounds familiar to some of our viewers, he happens to be the son of the President of the United States.
And proudly so, I might.
And proudly so. Scooter brought you a box of broccoli. That should be a base hit for Mattingly in the left center. No hesitation about going for two, and should hold up right there. Run down by Pettis in center field. And the Yanks with a leadoff double by Mattingly here in the fourth, a man to scoring position for Mel Hall. You see the pitch from Ryan, fastball out over the plate, and as Don Mattingly does so very well, uses the entire field, does not try to pull the outside pitch and simply shoots it up that left center field alley. And double number two for Mattingly. George, your team not playing extremely well here in the early goings of the season.
Right. We're patient.
You must be patient.
As
certainly.
You know, it's a long season, but we're not hitting the ball very well, and we don't hit well. We're not pitching well. You don't win. And had a tough series up in New York, although Witt and Huff pitched well. Nolan's getting rocked a little bit here. Doesn't look like he's got his great velocity.
No, he doesn't have good stuff tonight. Trying to pitch a little bit, change speeds. Charlie Huff lost a heartbreaker for your ball club
up
in New York.
But we were, you know, we were really encouraged by Charlie's performance. Mm-hmm. He had a bad year last year, at least a bad first half, and we got to have five starters to compete in our division. We drew a tough draw.
Your division is going to be very tough with the Oakland A's, of course, the world champions, California Angels, Minnesota Twins. Bounced by Hall to Palmeiro, and he'll shuffle off to Ryan at first for one out, but Mattingly gets to third base with one out here in the fourth inning.
It's like he hit.
Gives Dave Winfield a chance for a run batted in, a man at third, and less than two outs. There we are on camera, George. There's George Grant behind the Scooter. See Scooter with a hat on over there? That's Scooter with the Yankee hat on. Oh, he's turning around now. Scooter brought a box load of broccoli for you, too. He thought your dad was coming. Not that he was disappointed, but.
To use a basketball term, that would have been soundly rejected.
Here comes the Scooter with the broccoli. There he is.
To all you broccoli lovers, of which I am not one.
It runs in the family.
Well, in this case it does, although if I had to eat some, I'd eat this part and not the stalk. But
talking about your division with the A's, the Angels, Minnesota Twins, Kansas City Royals, going to be tough for you.
You bet. But
you're going to have to pitch well, and I feel you're going to have to get some production out of the bottom half of your lineup.
Which we've had so far, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. We have nothing out of the 3, 4, and 5 yet, but as you know, it's a game of patience because these guys are proven veterans and they'll hit well. It's middle relief has been weak for us too, Tom. But we got a good team. We had a good team last year. We're a little more seasoned. Our fans appreciate what we're trying to do. We got a good crowd here
tonight.
We
went over 2 million fans last year, the first time in the history of the ball club.
You bet.
A ball, no strikes to Dave Winfield. Don Mattingly at third. He doubled and went to third on Mel Hall's grounder. Hall doing a good job getting Mattingly over there. And now Winfield will try to get, with nothing else, a fly ball to the outfield. The Ranger infield is playing in. They're down by 2 runs. 2-0. They want to cut the run off if they can. Kind of a hitter's delight when you have the infield in. This is a good battle by 2 seasoned veterans. They haven't faced each other in 10 years. The other day in New York, when the Rangers were up at the stadium, Winfield and Ryan went at each other. Good fastball for a strike. That's a good pitch. Looks like Dave Winfield might be doing a little politicking and hopefully get a pitch later on, but that is a good major league strike right there.
Thing about Nolan, Tom, is you.
You see the reaction of Dave Winfield. I was saying that these two have not faced each other. The first time that they did face each other was up at the stadium. They hadn't seen each other in 10 years, hadn't gone head to head in 10 years. That should get the run in deep to center field. Gary Pettis will put it away for the out, but that's certainly far enough. And Don Mattingly trots home easily for run number 3 for the Yanks here in the fourth inning. And it is now 3-0 New York. You were saying, George,
I was just going to say that the thing, you know, I love about Nolan, he's been a friend of mine, a friend of our families for years, is what a tough competitor he is. Here he is 43 years young and battling like it's the World Series. He's a that might not have his best stuff tonight, but I guarantee he's got 100% effort. Great guy.
You will get 100% effort, and one of the keys is to,
you know, we signed him for next year.
Yes, with an option for next year. I talked to him about that, whether he will pitch or not.
What did he say?
He said he will see at the end of the year.
The thing about Nolan that's so great is that if he feels like he has it, he'll go, and he'll be honest with us.
Well, he's pitched so long, and I would assume that he will win number 300 this year.
You bet. Hopefully he'll win 292 tonight. Get him some runs. He's got a good cattle business, though. He's a good rancher. He knows what he's doing.
We take a look at the last pitch. Jesse Barfield going after the curveball in the dirt.
Cricket.
Well, that's tough. I mean, against Nolan, you have to commit early.
Yeah, he's good.
No balls, 2 strikes on Jesse Barfield. A run in for the Yanks here in the fourth. 2 outs. Don Mattingly with a leadoff double, and then came around to score on the sacrifice fly by Dave Winfield. And Jesse Barfield is out on the breaking ball, but the Yanks come up with a run on a hit, the leadoff double, and then the sacrifice fly. We go to the bottom of the fourth inning here at Arlington Stadium in Arlington, Texas. The New York Yankees 3, the Rangers nothing. Back back at Arlington Stadium as the Yankees lead the Texas Rangers 3-0 here in the bottom of the fourth inning. It'll be Sierra, Baines, and Incavilla. We're visiting with George Bush Jr., son of the President of the United States, one of the owners of this Texas Ranger ball club. In your second year of ownership, George, is that correct?
Second year.
Oh, right back to Andy Hawkins. I don't think they'll get Sierra here. First pitch, and Andy just could not come up with it. That should be an infield single.
You know, that is the third time in the last five at-bats that Sierra has hit the ball that has hit the pitcher's leg.
We'll take a look at it again. George trying to take my job here.
Oh, you're doing a great job.
No chance for Hawkins and no chance for Velarde at third. That'll bring up Harold Baines.
Now, this is a place where your owner, the boss, George Steinbrenner, who is a good friend of mine and a gracious host, has done wise judgment, Tom, to have you behind the mic.
Now, your second year of ownership, and how have the other senior owners treated you?
Very polite. I tell you, the Yankee owner has been nothing but nice to me, for which I'm very grateful, and had a good time. Fortunately, we got this labor thing behind us so we can play ball. I was worried about it from the fans' perspective, and I've really enjoyed it. I love the game. I've had a really interesting experience getting to know the 26 owners or the representatives of the clubs, and it's a varied group of unusual people, most of whom have been very successful in their life, all of whom are dedicated to the game.
That's one of the great things, is that so many of them are dedicated to the game, love the game strictly from the standpoint of the game of baseball is something they truly love.
National
number
treasure.
One that comes to mind is Gene Autry, of course.
You bet. I wish he'd win the pennant, but not this year, because we're in his division. No, it's a national treasure. I view it that way. It's just a part of America's fabric, and I really do believe that the other 25 owners feel the same way I feel. And
how much communication do you have with the other owners once the season gets going?
Some.
Like, how many times will you talk to a George Steinbrenner during the course of a season?
Oh, a couple of times at most, unless there's an issue at hand. But generally, it's because he is such a gracious host. If I'm up in New York, he'll make sure I'm treated well. But not too much. We leave all the baseball stuff to Tom Grieve, at least I do, and on our club. And so the general manager, Tom Grieve, handles most of the discussions about players. And other than any rule changes or baseball business matters, there's no need to talk to him.
Harold Baines, two balls and a strike. Nobody out here in the bottom of the fourth. The Yanks leading 3-0. We're visiting with George Bush Jr., one of the owners of this Texas Ranger ball club. Your father is a big baseball fan. I know that.
Pretty good player.
Good player in his day at Yale, of course. But a big baseball fan. He truly loves the game.
Yes, he does. If he had his way, he'd be at a lot of games. But when he comes, it takes a lot of seats away from good folks. So travels with a large entourage these days.
Bounce on one hop to Mattingly. Look at that play. Boy, that is some double play if they can turn it. Yes, they do. First base umpire Dan Morrison said, yes, Andy Hawkins got the bag. And what a double play. What a pair of hands Don Mattingly has. There's a man that takes as much pride in his defense as he does his hitting. We've talked about the consecutive gold gloves that Mattingly has won. Boy, one hop and just one step, he gets it out, and the relay by Espinoza very quickly right on the bag. This Yankee defense is one of the strengths of this ball club. This interior defense and outfield defense for New York is one of the finest in all of baseball. Spearheaded by that man right there. He is something at first base. So the possibility of a rally and then a double play, and now nobody on and two outs.
Stops rallies all the time, doesn't it, Tom?
Pitcher's favorite friend right there, the double play ball.
This guy's been a real joy to work with. He's really happy and friendly. Incavilla now. He's done some pretty good damage in the bottom part of our lineup. Coming into his own.
Yeah, you got to get some production from him.
Sure do.
Your father, George Bush, of course, the President of the United States, and his uncle was G. Herbert Walker, who was a one-time owner of the New York Mets.
That's right.
And
how I learned.
Friend of ours.
He taught me the joys of being in baseball. I mean, when I saw how happy he was, win or lose for the Mets, I knew it was a place I'd like to eventually land. And was really lucky and
able to put
this
together.
Yeah,
he also loved the game of baseball.
He really did.
He was one of my favorite people.
He was a nut, which is a complimentary term.
Nicky Villa draws the base on ball, so after the double play, Hawkins with his third base on balls of the evening, and it'll bring up Gino Petralli. Your ball club is going to get a new stadium sometime in the near future.
Yes. As you can see, we need one.
The playing field is in great shape.
Well, we're not going to change groundskeepers, and I don't think we'll be vacuuming our field because it's going to be on grass if I have anything to do with it. We'll keep it outdoors.
I'm glad to hear that.
We got the best groundskeeper.
Petralli with a base hit to right, and Incavilla is going to stop at second. So, without the help of the double play ball off the bat of Harold Baines, this could have been already a big inning for the Texas Rangers. Two hits and a base on balls in the inning, but there are two outs and runners at first and second, and it'll bring up Steve Buschel. With single runs in the second, third, and fourth innings. Home runs by Mel Hall and Rick Cerrone, and then a sacrifice fly by Dave Winfield. They lead the Rangers 3-0. How far away from you, George, are we from possibility having a new ballpark here?
Tommy, it's hard to tell. We're looking at all alternatives. We're taking our time because it's such a huge decision for this part of the world. As you know, we got a big area to choose a location.
You draw from Dallas, you draw from Fort Worth.
Many cities around the Metroplex, Waco, Tyler, Longview. So we're going to take our time. I don't know. I wish I could tell you, but we don't have, we're not far enough down the road to even be putting out a timetable. When it's done, it's going to be a beautiful place for people to watch baseball.
That's hit hard in the alley to right center. We'll see if Jesse Barfield can run it down. No, he can't. Nicky Villa is going to score. Petralli is going to score. And a big two-out double by Steve Buschel. And the Texas Rangers have drawn to within a run. It is now 3-2. Buschel with his fourth and fifth RBI of the season. And George, you talked about it before, but you're getting production in the bottom half of this lineup, where you really don't expect it or not looking for it, not getting in the middle of the lineup, but Buschel gets a pitch up in the strike zone and drives it up that right center field alley.
That's
and
right.
The Rangers are on the board.
These guys have been carrying our club offensively so far this year, and I think that's a good sign because, as you know, the big boys will start playing here pretty soon.
That'll bring up Jeff Huesen with two outs and a tying run at second base. Hawkins are really breezing right along. Ruben Sierra started the inning off with a single off of Hawkins' leg, and then Harold Baines hit in the double play, and then a walk, a single, and a double, and the Rangers have moved to within a run. You talked about Nolan Ryan before about not having good stuff tonight. One of the things that a starting pitcher really should be number one on their list is keep the club in the ball game.
That's right.
Even if you don't have good stuff, keep them in the ball game and give them a chance to win. Espinoza sneaking in behind Buschel at second.
Well, the great thing about Nolan, Tom, is he's got the experience to know how to do that. I mean, he understands that better than anybody. Like yourself, he was a tough competitor who plays hard enough to keep the team tight. That's right.
1-1 to Huesen, and Hawkins has really started getting the ball up in the strike zone. Mechanically, it seems to be off just slightly, the shoulder rotation. And all of a sudden, that changes the angle of the throwing arm to home plate. Instead of getting the ball down, everything seems to be up right around the letters. One of the things you have to do as a pitcher is understand that when it's happening, not have a pitching coach have to come out and tell you, know yourself and know what's happening. There you see Billy Connors, the pitching coach, and he's going to the phone. We'll probably get some action in the Yankee bullpen. 3-1 to Huesen, taking all the way, and that turns it over to the top of the lineup, and Gary Pettis will bat with two strikes and runners at first and second. You see Lee Guterman out of that dugout bullpen, and he'll start to get loose for the Yanks. Bucky Dent was looking at a 3-0 lead at the start of this inning, and the Rangers have rallied with 3 base hits and a couple of base on balls, and they've closed to within a run. That'll bring up Gary Pettis, who is 0 for 2 on the evening. Pettis came in hitting 269.
He's been a big help to us, Tom. We were a little weak in defense, not a little weak. We were weak in defense last year. Gary's really made a difference in our outfield. Inky and Ruben are playing better outfield as a result of having Gary out there. He's taking command like he should in center field.
Well, you went out and got one of the best defensively. Yeah. A gold glover, and he can play center field with anybody in baseball.
You bet. Good guy.
And there are a lot of good center fielders in baseball right now. One of them out in center field right now, and Roberto Kelly as well.
And he's a great player.
Off-speed pitch, and Pettis swings right through it. It's no balls and 2 strikes.
We need the gold bat right now, not the gold glove.
You'll get the gold bat. This ball club from 2, 3, 4, and 5 hitters are going to be as good as anybody in baseball. And over the course of the season, you know the numbers for those kinds of individuals even out. You know Palmeiro and Franco, Sierra, and Baines are going to hit. Chases the high fastball, and Andy Hawkins pitches out of it, but not before giving up a couple of runs on 3 hits. We've been visiting with George Bush Jr., one of the owners of this Texas Ranger ball club. George, thanks for coming by and chatting with us.
You betcha. Thanks.
It's the Yankees 3, Rangers 2. We'll be back. Back at Arlington Stadium, where the Texas Rangers have cut the Yankees lead to 1. Yankees 3, Rangers 2. A big inning for Texas. Could have been even bigger had the Yanks not turned the double play. It'll be Roberto Kelly, Rick Cerrone, and Randy Velarde for the Yanks here in the 5th against Nolan Ryan. 43-year-old right-hander who has legendary numbers. There are 16 pages in the Texas Ranger press guide devoted to the accomplishments of Nolan Ryan. He has won 291 games in his major league career and lost 263, going for number 292 here tonight. Kelly, a strikeout victim in the 2nd. Ryan has struck out 6 so far in his 4 innings of work. Ryan struck out 301 hitters last year. He went over the 300 mark for the 6th time in his career. And he gets Kelly again, strikeout number 7. He went over 300 strikeouts last year for the 6th time in his career. Kelly way out in front of the breaking ball. And the last time that he had done it before that was 12 years ago, 1977.
Holy cow.
12 years ago when he was with the California Angels. Rick Cerrone pops it. And Jeff Fusion should put it away. He does. There are 2 outs here in the 8th inning. Well, we have lost George Bush, but we have gained Phil Rizzuto.
Yes,
and his New York Yankee cap, and it seems to have worked, Scooter.
Worked. John Moore said this would break the jinx, and I tell you, this hat is beautiful. I don't know whether John's going to get it back or not. The material is great. There it is. Listen, where's that? Wait, where's that camera? You can't see this from there, can you? Can they see that from there? Too bad they can't see. Oh, you see what I see. Okay, I'm going to have to get this picture taken because it ruined my whole day.
I have a feeling I'm going to get the needle sooner or later.
You're going to get the needle. I can't believe this. I'm reading a great article here in the Sports Illustrated. Was it a better game in Ted's day? And they got a picture of Ted Williams, and they're talking about the salaries and how much fun it was to play in the old days, even though you didn't get any money and the gloves were smaller in the field. And pitch. And all of a sudden, I come to this page with a beautiful display of Tom Seaver. I can't believe it. Well, I want to tell you, he's got some agent. Here he is, big number 41 on the billboard. He's standing there with the ball with his legs crossed, standing up, little smirk on his face.
They're thinking of you, Scooter.
Seaver and Rolex, terrific. And now the thing is, I didn't, it says, this is what really hurt. It says, a future Hall of Famer, Tom Terrific, was Rookie of the Year, three-time Cy Young recipient, winner of 311 games. I didn't even know you won 300 games. I can't believe it.
You didn't know I won 300 games, huh? You know when I did
know,
that, Scooter?
I know. I don't want to talk about it. But listen to this. Beyond statistics and awards, Tom's intellectual approach to the game set a professional standard which won him the respect of the entire sports world. This is what I like. Also
Scooter,
respected.
Scooter, do you go around just reading advertisements and magazines?
Well, when I find you, I found about 80. You only get the best
ones. Why do you have to read?
He gets American Express, Rolex, standing on the beach in those cute little knickers with a nice dog.
One ball, two strikes. Two outs here in the bottom of the fifth.
No. This is not a plot to get a free Rolex watch. Unbelievable.
As that may sound.
Especially the Rolex Oyster chronometer that Steve is wearing.
Engraved with your name, is that what you're saying? Velarde strikes out, and here in the bottom of the fifth inning, the Yanks go 1-2-3. We go to the top of the sixth inning. It'll be Palmeiro, Franco, and Sierra, the middle of the Texas Ranger lineup. And the score after five innings of play is the Yankees 3, the Rangers 2. Now let's pause for station identification. Well, fans, the Yankees' next homestand begins on Tuesday, April 24th, and features a three-game series against the Seattle Mariners, April 24th through the 26th, and then the Angels on April 27th, 8th, and 9th, and the world champion Oakland A's come to town on April 30th, May 1st, and 2nd. In addition, April 28th and 9th is Citibank Yankee Cap Weekend, and Monday, April 30th, is the Wiz Yankee Poster Night. Please note that the next homestand will conclude on Thursday afternoon, May 3rd, when the Yanks host the Indians at 1 o'clock in a makeup game that does not appear on your Yankee schedule. Tickets are on sale now at the stadium and through Ticketmaster. What are you laughing at now, Scooter?
I asked George Grant to get my nice little white bag, and he spilled coffee all over it. I usually do that. Nice going, George. Anyway, on this day, in 19... I better get it out and read it. Let's see. 1967, Tom Seaver, the New York Mets, won his first major league game with a 6-1 triumph over the Chicago Cubs. Every place I look, I see Seaver's name in the paper, and magazines, billboards. What am I doing?
Palmeiro and Mattingly takes it by himself. And there's one out here in the bottom of the fifth. The Yankees with single runs in the second, third, and fourth. They led 3-0, and then the Rangers sent seven men to the plate in the fourth inning. Big blow. Two-run double by Steve Buschel up the right center field alley. And it is now a one-run ball game. Now what else you got? You have all kinds of little tidbits tonight,
don't you? I love grits, but they had a grits contest.
Is he playing tonight?
No. I had left in Charlotte, North Carolina. So grits aren't just for breakfast anymore. They had a World Grits Festival. I can't believe it.
Julio Franco, and that's going to drop in there for a single. Almost the same line that he hit it last time. Right at Roberto Kelly, but this time off the end of the bat. And the Rangers are hacking at Andy Hawkins again.
You know, it's hard to believe, but that's the first hit that Franco has gotten for Hawkins. Only in about 17 times in bat, but it doesn't seem possible. This is as good a hitter as he is.
He hit one right on the nose last time in the third inning. Lined it out to Kelly in center field. That'll bring up Ruben Sierra. Switch hitting right fielder for the Rangers. Maybe the finest young player in the game, arguably so. You could say Jose Canseco. You could say Bo Jackson. Eric Davis.
Yeah, there's a lot of them.
Oh, there's a lot of them.
Exciting ball player. But this guy is, I mean, he just narrowly missed being the most valuable player last year.
29 home runs last year, 21 of them here at Arlington Stadium. Hawkins keeping Franco close at first. Franco, a couple of stolen bases. He had 21 last year and was thrown out only three times. And Bobby Valentine likes the running game. I don't know if I'd go. I'd leave that hole wide open for Sierra down there. Boy, that really helps a hitter. And it causes a pitcher a lot of problems when you have to pitch against a big hole in the infield. And they have been getting Sierra out with off-speed stuff, and off-speed stuff is the thing that you would pull in that hole directly. He was going for it. The Yankees ought to turn it again. Boy, they do. There's something on that infield defensively. Second double play in two innings. This one 4-6-3. The 11th double play the Yanks have turned, and not, they get Andy Hawkins out of a possible jam. We're done with 5.5 here in Texas. Yankees 3, Rangers 2.
All right, here's tonight's trivia quiz. Nolan Ryan, Ron Davis, and Roger Clemens are tied for the American League lead in consecutive strikeouts. Eight consecutive strikeouts. Who owns the major league record? Who printed this? John Moore, who print this? Whoever printed it does not make C's very well. Look at this.
What?
Does that look like a C to you?
Record. Who owns the major league record?
Oh, record. Okay. Who owns the major league record? Well, it doesn't look like a C to me, but.
Top of the lineup for the Yanks here in the sixth inning. We're through five, and the Yanks with 3 runs on 3 hits. Rangers 2 runs on 5 hits. 2 of the Yankee runs home runs, Mel Hall and Rick Cerrone. Steve Sachs 0 for 2 and was caught stealing in the third inning. Nolan Ryan working. He has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 strikeouts so far through 5 innings. More strikeouts than any other major league pitcher in history. You know, 5,000 strikeouts.
Very interesting. What you told me.
Over 2,500 base on balls as well.
I imagine how many pitches he's on. But you were even amazed. You struck out over 3,500, and you're how far behind Ryan? I mean, it's nothing.
Steve Sachs hits it hard, but will not be far enough, and Sierra puts it away for out number one here in the sixth. I played for 20 years and I had a lot of strikeouts. I had over 3,500.
I know it.
I mean, that's a lot.
It's a lot.
I'm still 1,500 behind him.
It's hard to believe, but
199 times he has struck out 10 or more.
How many did you have?
Did I struck out 10 or more?
Yeah.
I don't know. Alvaro Espinoza with an out, and on the first pitch with the defense playing Espinoza to right field, that's an easy fly for Sierra, and very quickly 2 flyouts here in the sixth inning. I talked earlier about how Nolan Ryan has 16 pages in the press guide, all of his accomplishments. The most I've ever seen in any press guide. They have Hall of Famers that he struck out, all kinds of things. Mm. One of the things they do have, the Ryan strikeouts of father and sons.
Uh-huh.
Sandy and Roberto Alomar, Bobby and Barry Bonds, Tito and Terry Francona, the Griffies, Ken Griffey Jr., Ken Griffey Sr., Dick Schofield Jr. and Sr., Maury and Bump Wills.
How do you like that?
They've got all kinds of, they got MVPs that he struck out. One person that has no strikeouts so far this year, second in the league and toughest to fan last year, Don Mattingly.
Yeah, he is tough.
It was tough. Short stroke, used the entire field.
And getting off to his best April start, that's very unusual for Matt.
And a big double in the fourth inning. Two balls a strike with two outs. Nolan has walked but one, given up just three hits. Two of them home runs. Oh, Mattingly chasing a half pitch there, didn't he?
We very seldom see Mattingly go for a pitch that much out of the strike zone.
Well, he saw it up in the strike zone and behind in the count, and Ryan again going to the changeup, gets it up. Don was way out in front of it. Looked like a good pitch to hit, but you can see here now, watch the swing, how far out in front he is.
Mm-hmm.
He'll get a fastball here, I would think.
Yeah,
he does, and he rips it right up that alley, but Gary Pettis is right there. So for the Yanks here in the sixth inning, three up, three down on three fly balls. We go to the bottom of the sixth. The Rangers will set up Baines, Incavilla, and Petralli, with the Yankees leading by one, 3-2. Yankee fans, just a reminder to all of those watching on PIX, Channel 11 will present a special all-new miniseries, Voyage of Terror, starring Burt Lancaster and Eva Marie Saint, and filmed aboard the actual Achille Lauro cruise ship, site of the terrorist hijacking. This special airs in two parts on Tuesday and Wednesday, May 1st and 2nd, both nights at 8 o'clock. Eva Marie Saint, you remember her, Scooter?
Oh, man, North by Northwest.
Wasn't that something?
What a great movie. Oh. And also On the Waterfront, she played with Marlon Brando.
Who was the male lead in North by Northwest?
Cary Grant. I patterned my style of dress after Cary Grant.
I noticed that today. You're looking rather dapper. Oh,
you got to be kidding. He could really dress. Man, he was something.
He was a big baseball fan, too. He used to go to Dodger Stadium a lot.
They all wanted to be seen at Dodger Stadium.
Baines, Incavilla, and Petralli for the Rangers here in the sixth. Andy Hawkins trying to protect a one-run lead, and Baines is out number one. There is activity in the Yankee bullpen. Lee Gutterman is up and throwing.
Will they still be counting pitches after this time?
I would think they still be counting pitches, certainly.
Yeah. It's only been, I think, one complete game in each league so far this year.
There are two pitchers in the American League with 3-0 records. Ryan trying to extend his record to 3-0. Clemens is 3-0. Dave Stewart has won three and lost none.
Stewart, he's unbelievable at the start of the year. He really gets a big jump on everybody.
Incavilla with a walk in the fourth inning, scored one of the Ranger runs. He is so strong. He can hit that ball out to right center. Good power to the opposite field. If he ever harnesses it and makes contact. Wow. Oh, he drops that backside, Scooter, doesn't he?
Yeah.
That whole backside goes down, and the bat hit goes through the strike zone and an upward lane, goes over the top of a lot of pitches.
He makes contact, you know it.
Count remains the same, a ball and two strikes.
Yeah, I was watching a college game on ESPN, Georgia Tech and North Carolina. And they were using that aluminum bat. And we're hitting them on the end of the bat and on the fist going out of the park. And this guy had some great year in college.
Jams in, but he fouls it off. The Rangers came in tonight with a 4-6 record. They've not been playing well lately. They're 4.5 games back. They got just four hits last night as Chris Bosio shut them out. The Milwaukee Brewers, the Rangers lost 11-0. Four hits and all singles. That one just missing outside. Of course, the Yanks got shut out themselves. They got just five hits.
At least it was respectable. The two games that the Rangers played here before the Yankees came in were two of the worst they've played all year. First game they made, I don't know how many errors, they had 11 walks. turned out to be the longest game they ever played here at Arlington Stadium.
Well, it is a staff that will walk a lot of people.
Yep.
3-2, and Incavilla is out on strikes route number two in the sixth.
All right, here is the trivia answer. Nolan Ryan, Ron Davis, and Roger Clemens are tied for the American League consecutive strikeout record with 8. Who owns the Major League record? See, I can't tell. I can't believe it. Again, Tom Seaver with 10. 10 in a row you struck out.
Is that, was that me? I didn't.
I can't. I can't believe
it. I was over here doing the old lobby.
10 in a row. 3, 6, 9, 10. Unbelievable.
Well, I had to. I was ahead 2-1 in the game. I gave up a home run in the game.
Is that right?
Sure.
But your fastball must have taken off a little bit, like Ryan's too, right?
Mm-hmm. On certain days, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Get that ball to pop a little bit.
On a lot of days.
A little bit of slider.
Yeah.
Gino Petralli. Couple of singles.
Did you ever cut your knee when you, no. Your knee always hit the ground?
No, I wore a knee pad.
Did you really?
Yeah, one of those basketball knee pads.
Smart.
I wore one of those. Used to bruise it, and then I finally smartened up after a few years and put a knee pad on there.
I don't know of any other pitcher that does it.
Oh, there's some, I think. I can't name
not
it.
Not as consistently
some.
As you.
There's some that wore a knee pad on the other leg as to protect their arm. Their arm would come around, and they'd hit themselves on the leading knee, yeah. Petralli came into the game hitting 190. He's got two base hits here off of Andy Hawkins, two singles. Boy, and there's another one. On a 3-2 pitch, just going with a fastball on the outside part of the plate, and he shoots it between Velarde and Espinoza. And so with two outs, the Rangers have a base runner. Petralli is 3-for-3. And that brings up Steve Rochelle, who had the big base hit for the Rangers in the fourth. Good piece of hitting, Scooter.
Oh, boy, I tell you. It's amazing. He said he was batting under 200 before the start of the game. Looks swinging that bat real well. And this next guy is the guy that made a living out of hitting Yankee pitching at Bouchel.
Well, they keep making the kind of pitches that Hawkins made to him last time up. Just let the ball up and out over the plate.
That whole inning he was getting everything up.
Everything was up, yeah. Time call. There's a ball on the field in right field. Home plate umpire Rocky Rowe calling time. Don Mattingly will play behind Petralli at first with two outs. And somebody runs that Tom Seaver fastball down. Yankees lead it here in the bottom of the sixth inning, 3-2. Two outs. A tying run at first, and now the tying run at second. A breaking ball down in the dirt, and Rick Cerrone can't keep it out in front of him, and the Rangers get the tying run into scoring position. Boy, they lost last night, Scooter, on a pass ball or a wild pitch. Well, pass ball.
A shame. That's a wild pitch, that one bounced in the dirt, but Cerrone was charged with a pass ball and earned run. The only run that Pascual Perez gave up.
So Hawkins now have to make a decision, or the decision might come from Bucky Dent or Billy Connors if they want to pitch to Bouchel. With first base open in a one-run ball game, you would think that Bobby Valentine would hit for Jeff Husen if Bouchel gets on.
Mm-hmm.
Strike on the outside part of the plate, and the count is a ball and a strike. Michelle now with 5 RBIs as you look at the Ranger bench. There's Bobby Valentine, number 2, to his direct left, Davey Lopes, who was former infielder with the Dodgers, and on the other side of the field, Bucky Dent, looking at the tying run at second. Keep that runner close at second. You may not pick him off, but what you can do is possibly shorten him up just a step. So if there is a base hit, the outfielder might have a chance to throw him out. You might take away one step of him trying to score. Big swing at the high fastball, and the count goes to a ball and two strikes. Hawkins, when he gets in trouble, just seems to get the ball up in the strike zone. Lee Gooderman in the bullpen has been throwing, and he is ready. Jimmy waiting. We may see him next inning. Now that Hawkins is, for all intents and purposes, gone through the lineup twice. Down to Hardy, and he can't make the play.
He played that very poorly that time.
One thing you have to do in that situation, even if you can't make the play, you gotta knock it down.
Gotta knock it down.
You gotta save the run.
Yep.
Well, Hardy tried to backhand the ball, Scooter. And
yeah.
You got to get in front of that ball and somehow knock it down and save a run. That'll bring Bucky Dent out to the mound, and the Rangers with two runs in the fourth inning and another one here in the bottom of the sixth have now tied it at 3-3. He just is.
I know it.
He tried to flag that ball instead of get on top of it. Well, Andy Hawkins. A tough break there. And we will see Lou Gooderman. So while a pitching change is being made, as we take one more look at Randy Velarde, who just could not flag that ball down, allowing Petrolli to score. Well, anyway, we'll have a pitching change that will be made, and we'll take this timeout along the Yankee Baseball Network for the following messages. The Texas Rangers have tied it here in the bottom of the sixth inning in Arlington, and Andy Hawkins leaves. He cannot be the winner and conceivably could be the loser. Boy, Randy Velarde, he feels badly about a ball that he should have knocked down. Anyway, Lee Gooderman will come on and pitch to Jeff Kunkel. Bouchel at second base represents the go-ahead run for the Rangers. A couple of big base hits by Steve Bouchel, both of them doubles and both of them with two outs, Scooter.
Yep. Drove in all three runs.
So it'll be up to Lee Gooderman. We'll try to put a stop on this Ranger rally. No action in the Texas Ranger bullpen. You can bet for sure that Nolan Ryan will be back out there and be in hot pursuit of win number 292. Kunkel batting just 130 on the year. Three hits and 23 times at the plate. For Gooderman, this is his third game. He's not given up a run. Pitched five innings, given up a couple of hits. Very valuable asset out of that bullpen. Bouchel at second, representing the go-ahead run for Texas. The 1-2 pitch. And the count goes to 2-2. Two's on the board, Scooter. Deuce is wild.
Ooh, they're gonna be lucky for him.
Yep. Field line and into the seats. Pretty decent crowd here tonight. They have not announced it yet, I don't think. It'll be around 30,000.
much stuff. This kind of weather, it probably had a lot more, but it rained.
I'm surprised to see this many people out here. Of course, knowing that Nolan Ryan was going to be on the mound, a big draw here in Texas.
That's something, isn't it? Every time he pitches, he's worth all the money they pay him.
Gooderman gets him on the check swing. Home plate umpire Rocky Rose says, yes, you went. And Lee Gooderman comes on and does the job, but not before the Texas Rangers come up for the run here in the bottom of the sixth to tie it. Big play that Randy Velarde did not make a third. We go to the seventh, all tied at three. And on this scoreboard after sixth inning, it's the Yankees 3 and the Rangers 3. Now let's pause for station identification.
Well, here are the upcoming telecasts on WPIX. Channel 11 tomorrow night, 8:30 against Texas, Cataray against Huff. Tuesday, 7:30 against Seattle. And next Friday, April 27th, against the California Angels. So mark them down. So George Grand has rejoined us. And look like the Yankees might have the game in hand. And all of a sudden, Bouchelle gets hot and driven in all three runs, George.
What'd you guys do when I left? It was 3-0.
Yeah, I know. You gave us a good lead, good cushion, but.
You brought the lucky hat, the home run hat for Mel Hall, Rick Cerrone.
Now we got to get one with a win in it. Mel homered and then bounced to first base. And fly ball, shallow left field. That could be trouble. And it is. Oh, what a play by Bouchelle. Holy cow. I think Hall would have had a triple on it. Look at Bouchelle live. I don't think he thought he could catch it. That was some play, George.
He can't play this ball any better than Steve Bouchelle does. Back to the plate. It's the one place along the left field line that was vulnerable from every angle. But Bouchelle takes one look, comes back, another look, and then just sticks the glove out and gives it the ole.
Man, I see he had to reach back a little bit. That's amazing. And you had to be careful if Incaviglia didn't plow into him. So, fine play. One out, his Winfield. Dave struck out and hit a long sacrifice fly. Boy, I tell you. Ryan is throwing him some wicked curveballs. First time up, he threw one under Dave's chin, kind of shook him up. He threw him a curveball, and Dave almost fell down swinging at it. When Ryan comes close to you, you got to be a little shaken up.
One of the things Dave Winfield didn't miss last year was facing Nolan Ryan.
Oh, he held up. Did he? No, he said he went after it, and Winfield doesn't believe it, and I don't either. Look at Dave. That's a tough call. This is one they should leave to the slow motion television.
One thing that Ryan has been doing to Winfield all night is mixing up his pitches more than in any other of the Yankee power hitters. Give him the slow breaking ball, give him the fastball. He realizes his timing is off.
Yep. And bounces a one hopper to Bouchelle. He throws him out. Two away. Nolan Ryan, he is an amazing piece of work at that, George.
Now, Scooter, you mentioned the day that Tom Seaver won his first game, April the 20th, this date, 1967,
I think it was.
69, I think.
69?
Nolan Ryan won his first on the same date, 1968.
No kidding.
April the 20th against the Cardinals and Nelson Bryles.
It was 67, George.
Right.
For the first time, I'm right.
That's good.
69 was a big year when the Mets won everything, and Seaver was the big star.
Isn't that ironic that the two of them on the same date win there?
Strike. Nothing at two. Barfield been up twice, struck out both times by Ryan. Ryan has 8 strikeouts. Didn't strike anybody. Nobody out last inning or this inning so far. Ooh. One ball, two strikes.
Ryan and Hawkins went different directions after the first couple of innings. Ryan was struggling.
Yeah.
Gave up the two home run balls, and he is, even though he hasn't had his best stuff, he's gotten the game under control while Hawkins had his difficulties.
That's low, 2-2. Well, Barfield got a little bit of a break. That 0-2 fastball looked like it was right on the corner. Just about due to hit one out of here. Ball seemed to be traveling if he get it up in the air. Ooh, big cut, struck him out for the third time. Strikeout number 9. 3 up, 3 down, and at the end of 6.5, it's the Yankees 3 and the Rangers 3.
Back at Arlington, Texas, Lee Guterman is on, and the seventh inning stretch has everybody up on their feet, enjoying a night of baseball. Hi. This afternoon, it didn't look like anybody would be playing baseball tonight. It was pouring rain, stopped about mid-afternoon, and they've been able to get this game in, and breeze has kicked up a little bit. There were some showers around, but they've avoided the ballpark, and we got a good one going to the bottom of the seventh. The Yankees 3 runs, 3 hits, and no errors. The Rangers 3 runs, 7 hits, and no errors. For the Texas Rangers, Pettis, Palmeiro, and Franco do up.
What happens if you get hurt on the job, George?
This is dangerous for you up here tonight.
You know, they got that ledge there that I keep forgetting about, and I fell, hit my head on the camera.
You have to call Marty you fell tomorrow. And
yeah, no, I've got to find out if I get, what are they called?
Hazard pay?
Hazard pay, right. One ball, one strike. Pettis, switch hitter, is 0 for 3 tonight.
If you're just joining us, the Yankees took a 2-0 lead on home runs from Hall in the second, Cerrone in the third, tacked on another one in the fourth to lead 3-0, and then the Rangers came back with 2 in the fourth and another one in the sixth, tied up 3-3.
Hard grounded. Oh, look at that play. Oh, he had a really rifle at it, but looking at the ball, but he missed that easier one in last inning when Bouchel's grounder got by him for a double, but that was a tough chance.
This was the same kind of move that Velarde made on the ball further up the line when he was playing deep. This time he gets the glove on it, and then the good arm catches Palmeiro, but the one that got away was the one that tied the ball game in the last inning.
Yeah, that stayed down. This one came up, but he didn't get his glove down on the other one. Palmeiro takes a strike. He's 0 for 2, bounced the first twice, and walked.
A year ago, the Yankees had 7 different players at third base.
And off the fist is going to go in for a base hit. He hit him right off the hands. Hard enough to get over the infield. Mike.
Another look as Guterman tries to get it on the inside corner, but Palmeiro right on it. Didn't hit it hard, but enough to get it over Sachs.
You know, it's a shame the youngster Blowers was given a third base job and got off pretty well, but then he has struck out, I think, his last 6 times up for him. So they put Velarde in. Play like that could cause Velarde to start next time tomorrow.
They've tried to do some fine tuning with Flowers in his swing in the last couple of days, and they're hopeful that he'll get back in the groove. He has more raw power probably than anybody in the Yankees lineup.
Yep.
If he can harness it and relax at the plate.
When he does make contact, the ball jumps off the bat. One strike on Franco. Julio bounced to short, line to center, and single to center. Time is called. Well, time a little late, and it's up to the umpire's judgment whether he doesn't have to call time if he doesn't want it. Most of the time they give it to the batter. One man out. Bottom of the seventh. To right field. They'll hold him at second base. Oh, what a throw by Barfield. Ooh.
Again, keep in mind that there is water over this whole outfield, and any ball hit to the outfield, Barfield came in, took his time, then guns it in. But any ball hit to the outfield, and if you've got to play at the plate or a play on the base pass, the ball is going to be wet when they pick it up. And you can see this one splash its way to Barfield. Inside out, perfect swing. Look at that one skip along.
See all the water splash from Barfield. Jumped after it.
Alvaro Espinosa decoying a bit for Palmeiro rounding second. And the Yankees in a 3-3 ball game now with only one out. Facing two on and the big gun at the plate.
Rubén Sierra. Struck out, singled off the pitcher's glove, and then bounced into a double play. And that's what the Yankees need now. One out, first and second. All right, the Yankee dugout, strike one.
Jeff Robinson is up loosening in the Yankee bullpen. Keep in mind, with Gooderman, the left-hander, in there, we've got Baines do up next, and then Incavilla. Incavilla in his career is 7-for-11 against Gooderman. So you don't expect him to face him.
Uh-oh, that's gone. Oh, man, he went down and got that. And a three-run home run for Rubén Sierra. Holy cow. Now lead 6-3. You can see he's very unhappy, Bucky Dent, as is Gooderman. Look at Sierra went down to get that pitch. He is so strong. Well, the Rangers can look lousy for a week and the Yankees come in town, they get well. And Harold Baines takes a strike.
They always play well against New York, and this is no exception. Sierra, who was handled well by the Yankees at the series at Yankee Stadium, just rips on that one. And the home run is his second hit. He's 2-for-4. And importantly, a look down on it, and that's his pitch.
And the way he lifts that leg, and he gets everything into it, all the weight on the back leg pushing off. That's low. One ball, two strikes. One out. 6-3, the Rangers lead. Struck him out. So two men are out. And here comes Bucky out. And George, you mentioned how well Incavilla has done against Gooderman. And they got Robinson up in the bullpen. Yep, he wants him.
So Gooderman comes in to get the final out in the sixth inning on six pitches, but here in the seventh inning gives up three hits, a single to Palmeiro, a single to Franco, and then the home run by Sierra And the Yankees at one time leading this ball game 3-0, now trail it 6-3. And Robinson will come in to facing Cavilla. You're right, Scooter. The Yankees have always had trouble here in Arlington. Mm. And the Rangers, the last two ball games, by Bobby Valentine's admission and by the managing general partner George Bush's admission, stunk the place up.
Oh,
they
yeah,
played lousy baseball. They had errors, walks. Nothing went right. But tonight, they played solid baseball. And the Yankees opened the door for them, and they took advantage of it.
Yeah, but when you get the good pitching, and Ryan always gives you a well-pitched game.
And there's George Bush now.
He's going to be a lot happier tonight. Well, we got a moment here. That was some story that Michael Kay told us, wasn't it?
Ooh.
The writer for the news. And you're right in the height of that storm, terrible storm day, a lot of accidents. He was coming out of the Dallas-Fort Worth airport, and the cab spun and turned over and rolled down. And he said it's the first time he ever had a seatbelt on in the back seat. I never even knew they had seatbelts in the back seat in cab.
It's ironic. He said he never puts a seatbelt on when he gets in the back seat
right.
of a car. He did today, and it may have saved his life.
Absolutely. He said all he could think of was what happened to poor Billy Martin. But it's the same thing. He rolled down in a little ditch, and he said luckily the cab hit a tree, and he wasn't, I mean, no physical evidence that he was hurt, certainly shaken up. And his mom, Rosebud Kay, isn't that a great name? Rosebud Kay, back in New York, great Yankee fan, certainly has got to be feeling so much happier about you heard that story. You never know, a lot of accidents during that storm.
Fortunately, Michael's okay, Mom.
Yep. All right, here's in Cavilla. Now, he struck out twice and walked. He scored a run. Two men are out here in the bottom of the seventh. Right one. Bounces back, one and one. Two balls and a strike.
Gary Mielke is now up in the Texas Rangers bullpen, loosening a bit.
Low again outside, 3-1. Now Integrity's going to have a free rip. He's going to swing no matter where that was. Almost bounced to home plate, 3-2.
Pete Incaviglia has been a mystery to just about everybody who has tried to work with him. At times he'll demonstrate discipline and then he'll revert back to free swinging ways that have produced multiple strikeouts each year.
Well, Robinson ends the inning, but the damage is done. Three big runs on the homer by Sierra, and at the end of seven, it's the Rangers 6 and the Yankees 3. Did you find my pen?
Back in Arlington, Texas, where the Rangers are leading the Yankees 6-3, let's check the scoreboard. Milwaukee has defeated Boston 5-0. Baltimore over Detroit 6-0. It was Toronto 17, Kansas City 6. Minnesota 13, California 1. And now going into the third, Seattle and Oakland are scoreless in the American League.
Well, Montreal's giving the Mets a lot of trouble this year. They were complaining that Dennis Martinez was spitting tobacco juice on the ball.
Montreal has beaten the Mets 2-1 tonight.
Huh. Roberto Kelly leading off. Takes a strike.
And Gary Mielke is the new pitcher for the Texas Rangers. So Nolan Ryan who leaves the game with 9 strikeouts, was within one of striking out 10 or more for the 200th time in his career. But he was at 99 pitches, and they gave him a basic 100 mark tonight, so he bailed after number 99, and he got stronger as the night went on.
Yes, he did. I've been getting on Seaver all night. Here he went out and got me a nice cup of coffee. Not a bad kid. But that's something with that Ryan. He is the pitcher of record now. 292 if they can hold on, keep the Yankees from scoring. 1-2 on Roberto. He's had a rough night. He and Barfield. Barfield has struck out 3 times, Kelly twice, all against Ryan. And that's the 3rd time Kelly goes down. Looks like a...
Let's go to check the National League. We mentioned the Montreal Met game. 2-1 is the final. The Expos win it. Pittsburgh beat the Cubs 9-4. Philadelphia over the Cardinals 3-0. In the 5th inning, San Diego leads the Giants 5-0. And in the 3rd inning now, Los Angeles and Houston scoreless.
All right. A lot of pitching duels in that National League. Rick Cerrone homered and popped to short. Yankees have 2 homers tonight. Mel Hall, first home of the year for the Yankees, 2-0.
This could be a particularly frustrating night for the Yankees because they finally break the home run slump. They come back and get 2 of them. They have a 3-0 lead against Nolan Ryan, and going into the strong point of the pitching staff, that middle relief. And this is one night where usually reliable Lee Gooderman just could not hold it.
Yeah, he's been sensational with not allowing any runs after the night. Low, 3-0.
By the way, Deion Sanders has rejoined the club, so he is available for pinch hitting duties and pinch running duties in the closing innings.
Did they have the baby?
Yep.
Good.
8 pounds, 2 ounces, a baby girl.
All right.
Deandra.
Oh, great.
Deandra. Yeah,
pretty name. Deion got most of his name in there. Strike 2, 3-2. He's got a weird delivery, hadn't he?
He comes at you, especially from the right side, when he drops down a little bit.
In the hole. Oh, good play by Kunkel. And they get him. Pretty play by Jeff Kunkel. Son of the late umpire Bill Kunkel, also Bill pitched in the big leagues and for the Yankees.
Kunkel, who pinch hit for Houston, stayed in the game, and he demonstrates the ability to get to the ball, plants, and because Cerrone does not run well, has time to turn and throw.
That's a strong throw from the outfield grass. But here's Velarde. Rendy has walked and struck out. Ball one.
Kunkel at his best is very valuable in that he can play a number of positions. Last year, in terms of starters, he made more errors at shortstop than anyone else in the league. But he's a very valuable player that you can put him anywhere. He even pitched last year.
Yeah, they say he can really throw hard. 1-1, 2-out, 6-3. The Rangers lead here, top of the 8th.
He was back in New York last week when the Rangers were in town, looking forward to seeing his mom, and friends came to the ballpark each day. He needed 20, 30 tickets for each ball game.
Ground ball in the hole again. That was an easier chance. That one he could have gotten in front of, and he decided to try and make that same backhand play and hit him off the wrist.
You know, we talk about it, Scooter, and you patrolled out there so long that the most important plays are usually the routine
plays.
That's
right. They make more errors or let more of them get away because you don't just bear down as much as you do on a tough play. See that? He could have got in front of that. He stopped too soon. The other one, he had to go way to his right.
And he's going to be charged with an error.
And Bobby Valentine comes out. Jeff Russell warming and will come in from the Texas Rangers bullpen. So Valentine, after the way this club has played, does not want to mess around.
Well, remember when he brought this Jeff Russell in, gave the Yankees a big break, taking Charlie Huff out. The Yankees couldn't touch Huff. He walked one man. And he brought Russell in, and the Yankees scored all their runs off Russell.
By the way, remember the play that he made barehanding the ball towards third and then made a bad throw?
Yeah.
That next day in the locker room after the game, he said, we're going to work on that. Next day, they came home. They flew home. Next day was an off day. He had them here at the ballpark in a workout working on bunts, throws to second, throws to third.
Now, you're not talking about Huff's play.
No, I'm talking about Russell's play.
Yeah, Russell, right, because Huff made a great play. Wasn't that a great play? Yeah, Russell made it.
We, of course, will see Charlie Huff tomorrow. Cataray against Huff right here on WPIX at 8:30 Eastern time. Then on Sunday, it'll be Kevin Brown going for the Texas Rangers and Tim Leary going for the Yankees. So tomorrow night, 8:30, Cataray against Huff on Channel 11, and then on Sunday, Tim Leary against Kevin Brown to wrap up this series. Don't forget, we hope you enjoyed tonight's show preceding the ball game, our special on Billy Martin. A little bit later on this season, on May the 24th, we'll have our half-hour special on the Scooter, 50 years with the Yankees. Also a little bit later on, April 30th, Scooter, and I know you're looking forward to this. The great Mel Allen's going to join us in the booth. It will make 7 decades that he will have broadcast a baseball game. So he'll spend a game with us on April the 30th. You're a 5-decade broadcaster.
Yeah.
Did you ever think you'd last this long up here?
No, are you kidding? Ooh. Tough pitch. Sachs takes it for a strike. Bellotti at first base. 2 men are out. Sachs is 0-for-3 tonight. He's flied to center, bounced to short, flied to right. 1-1. This guy had a lot of saves last year, didn't he, that Russell?
He was a Rolaids winner in the American League and accomplished what only a couple of players have been able to do, and that was make it on the All-Star team 1 year as a starter the year before, and then last year as a reliever.
Hey, I like that. 1-ball, 2-strikes.
Valentine said after his performance at Yankee Stadium the other day that when Russell comes in and is not going one inning, and remember he came in the 8th inning, when he thinks he's got to go 2, he's just not as nasty. So he's told him, come in, go after him. If you only last an inning, fine, but just go after him and be aggressive.
Down to the short, and Kunkel gets the force at second base. The Yankees, nothing across. It was an error and a man left, and at the end of 7.5, it's the Rangers 6 and the Yankees 3.
Participating advertisers in New York Yankee Baseball are Advantage Dodge, only at your local Tri-State Dodge dealer. Budweiser, the king of beers. Remember, know when to say when. The Daily News, New York's hometown paper. Nobody tells it like the Daily News. And Citicorp, because Americans want to succeed, not just survive.
All right, Alan Mills on the mound for the Yankees now, the youngster, who looks like he's got a promising career ahead of him. He hasn't been too fortunate in his relief appearances, but he's really got good stuff.
Pitched an inning on Wednesday, allowed a couple of runs on 2 hits and walked 2 batters. Made his major league debut on Saturday. And he is one of the few athletes to go from A ball to the major leagues.
Mm-hmm.
Doc Gooden did it a few years ago, and Mills doing it here.
Base hit. That's going to be extra bases down in the corner. And Petrelli is 4-for-4. Here's a guy came in batting under 200. We told you when the Yankees come in town, they wake everybody up.
Scooter, he's got 8 hits on the year, 7 of them against the Yankees.
Oh, man. All right, here's Steve Buschel, who is 2-for-3, 2 doubles, has driven in 3 of the 6 runs.
This is a low ball hitting club, and Petrelli is one of them. And there, he gets the low inside pitch and just rifles it down the line. 3 singles and a double for Petrelli tonight.
And Buschel bunts. It'll go foul. Bobby Valentine playing for an insurance firm. You often wonder when a guy's hot like that, how you would ask him to bunt.
The way things have gone for Bobby Valentine the last week or so, he wants everything he can get.
Yeah, that's true. Shello made the defensive play of the night. Strike 2. Oh, he gave him the green light, let him swing away, and he took one right down the middle.
Certainly third base has been a turning point tonight for both teams, for Buschel at the plate,
right,
and for the Yankees in the field.
Yep. Did not throw the ball, Espinosa. Had to check his swing. Don't hit his bat. Stays at nothing and 2.
Yankees are very high on this young man. A fastball, slider, changeup. He's a competitor. 6'1", 190 pounds, native of Lakeland, Florida. 23 years of age.
Slice foul.
Trying to get inside on Buschel. He's got
look at this
a pitch that will give you a bird's eye view of exactly where that foul ball went. Scooter,
these cameramen are tricky. Got him. Went fishing for a good breaking pitch. So they finally get Buschel out.
He throws a hard slider and also throws 2 different versions of his fastball, which can leave you guessing. And after the strikeout with Buschel, Espy comes in and will run for Petrelli.
If he had laid down the bunt to get Petrelli over, he probably would have left him in the game. But Espy with good speed. High pop up. And Velarde makes the catch. 2 men are out. Towering pop fly.
Lucky getaway by Mills. He delivers that ball, and Espinosa is almost standing on second base. Espinosa had flashed the sign to Mills. Mills didn't even check the runner. Again, a young man's mistake. Watch closely. There comes Espinosa.
Yeah. Mills is concentrating so hard, he just completely forgot about a possible pickoff. This is a tough one for Velarde. Boy, he got to stay with it. And Gary Pettis the batter. He's 0 for 4. Bounced out three times and struck out once.
Yankees believe in Alan Mills and Willie Smith. They have two potential closers in the minor leagues, the philosophy being that Mills will go back down when the roster goes to 24 or 25.
All right, Mattingly makes the unassisted put out. Nothing across, a man left, and at the end of eight full innings, it's the Rangers 6 and the Yankees 3.
Good evening. Soviet troops reportedly stormed a printing plant in Lithuania today. Shipments of wood, food, and industrial parts all diverted. President Bush says he's increasingly concerned. Pete Rose says he's not a bad person, but that he did some bad things. He pleaded guilty to two federal income tax charges. And Georgia Senator Sam Nunn says the defense budget could be cut by $6 billion with less for Star Wars and the MX missile. For USA Tonight, I'm Graham.
Back at Arlington, Texas, a look at a couple of the key plays of this ball game. First of all, in the sixth inning, 3-2 ball game. Runner on second. Bouchel hits this one down the third baseline. It gets by Velarde for a double. Petrelli scores, and that ties it 3-3. And then Ruben Sierra gets this low pitch and plants it in the left field seats for a three-run home run. And the Texas Rangers have a 6-3 lead over the Yankees as we go to the ninth inning. And Polonia will pinch hit for Espinosa to lead it off. Mattingly and Hall to follow.
All right, little Louis swinging a hot bat. It's a pitch high, ball one. Polonia, 5'8", 152 pounds. 1-1. Another Dominican Republic ball player. They got so many come out of there. Outside, 2-1.
Mike Stanley, the new catcher. Bouchel in at third. Palmeiro even with the bag at first, guarding against a possible bunt.
Oh, that's going to be a base hit, and he stuck his bare hand out. That could, he could really be hurt. Automatic reflex action by the pitchers. The manager got to be worried about that.
This happened to the Yankees about 2 weeks ago when Chuck Carey did the same thing, reflex action, ground ball up the middle. And here Russell sticks the right hand out, and it hits the flesh part of the palm, right square in the palm, and bounces off. He says he's okay, looks to the bench. Tom House yelled out to him. He says, I'm okay, and doesn't even take an extra pitch as Mattingly steps in.
No, he was lucky, as you said, it hit him right in the palm. Had it hit him in the fingers, that's when you get really in trouble. All right, Mattingly now. Dunn is 1-for-3 with a double and takes a strike. Oh, that's gone. Oh, he got all of that one. Mattingly puts the Yankees one run behind, a towering home run for Don Mattingly, his first of the year, the Yankees' third of this ball game. And don't go away, Jeff Robinson. All right, fans, you know what happens every time a Yankee hits a home run. It puts the Yankees closer in the ball game.
Hey, we talked about it at the start of the game, Scooter. This is Don Mattingly's birthday. He has hit 368 on his birthday in his career. And you know when his last April home run was?
No.
April 20th, 1987.
And what's today's day?
The 20th of April. That was his birthday that day and his birthday this day. The last time he hit a home run in April.
Well, that's right. Your birthday stays the same. There's a foul back by Mel Hall, who homered.
Another look at Russell. Gives him the breaking ball, and Mattingly just is right on it. And the wind was blowing in at this time, too.
Yep.
You're right, Scooter. You called it gone, and that wind just kept pushing it back.
Yep. Scared me a little bit when it got up that high. But since they enclosed this stadium, it does give the hitters a lot more of an edge. Before, it was really tough to hit one out of here.
All right, Yankees now just trailed by one, 6-5 here in the top of the ninth. Swing and a miss, strike two. Nolan Ryan had thrown two hard fastballs by Mel Hall his first time up in the second inning, and then the third one he hit a line drive over the right field fence. Mel 1-for-3 on the night. Ground ball foul.
Now some encouraging signs tonight. The three home runs, one by Hall, one by Cerrone, and this one by Mattingly. And Hawkins pitched well going into the sixth inning and then just ran out of gas.
Yep. Low. One ball, two strikes. You could tell he was getting tired. Everything was up. High fly to left field. In Caviglia coming on. The wind taking it. Conkelhout in Caviglia makes the catch. It's not an easy play. One man out. Shot off the hand might have cost Russell that home run too. Look at Incaviglia. He's not too sure of this.
Incaviglia is a very aggressive outfielder. He is not categorized
as an
outstanding outfielder, but he'll try to get to everything he can. And in this particular weather, with the way the field is, anything out there can be dangerous.
Yep.
Gary Pettis, a Gold Glover, slipped and fell on a ball last night, and it's even worse tonight.
Yeah, they've been very fortunate out there that nobody has really slipped. Wetness has caused an extra base. At that time, there was a lot of white showing on the heel of the Incaviglia's glove. Two balls, no strikes. Winfield 0-for-2 with a sacrifice fly.
While we're talking about it, his last home run was September 14th. You think he's about due? September 14th of 88.
88, yeah.
Wouldn't it be nice?
It would be lovely. 3-0. You get one in the air tonight, just about any place, and it's gone if you hit it fairly well. Right one, 3-1. I mentioned before how when Russell came in to relieve Charlie Huff in New York, Huff had really handcuffed him. Take care of it. Russell was the loser. Ooh, he had his pitch and just fouled it. 3-2.
That was the best possible scenario for the Rangers, the knuckleballer, then the fastball. And
yep.
Here it's just power against power.
Poor Winfield had his cut right there.
He was on it.
Mm-hmm. All four. Look at Russell wanted that, but it was inside. So the Yankees still alive. Here in the top of the ninth, they trail by a run. One man out.
You can look for yourself as Stanley gives him the sign. Inside corner.
It was tailing in all the way, and Stanley pulled it back just a wee bit. Valentine talking with Russell.
Winfield representing the tying run. Barfield the lead run. With one out, top of the ninth inning, Rangers lead the Yankees 6-5 at Arlington.
Barfield has been up three times, has struck out all three times.
All against Ryan.
Yep.
He was numbers 3, 6, and 9 for Nolan Ryan tonight.
Well, we're going to have a runner now for Winfield.
Dion.
Dion, all right. A new daddy. Him one way or the other.
Now remember, there was some question when he played for Atlanta and they played the Dallas Cowboys about some late hits.
Uh-huh. Deion's got to be careful. You know, you come in a game this late in the game after sitting on the bench all night, you're not quite as sharp as you'd like to be, and you're not loosened up as much as you'd like to be. Double play ball. Holy cow, hit it right on the nose. But a double play, and that'll do it. The ball game is over. The Yankees almost do it. The final score, the Rangers 6 and the Yankees 5.
Here's the latest in the Channel 11 newsroom. More than 5,000 Haitians take to the streets to protest discrimination.
At City College of New York, the protest is over the teachings of white superiority. One professor is under fire and under investigation.
Wall Street's junk bond king, Mike Milken, says he'll plead guilty to charges of inside trading.
And Pete Rose has copped a plea. He could do jail time now for tax evasion. For Channel 11 News, I'm Tim Malloy.
Back at Arlington, Texas, the final on this one before 26,648. The Texas Rangers defeat the New York Yankees 6-5. The Yankees jumped out to an early lead of 2-0 on home runs by Hall and then another one by Cerrone. They tacked on another run in the fourth inning after Mattingly doubled and Winfield's sacrifice fly brought him in. And that's where the Yankees stood until the ninth inning. Meanwhile, the Texas Rangers came up with their runs, getting two runs in the fourth inning, another run in the sixth inning to tie it 3-3, and then the gamer was a three-run home run off Lee Gutterman by Ruben Sierra. The Yankees came back in the ninth inning. Don Mattingly's two-run home run pulled them to within one. Mattingly's first home run since April the 20th, his birthday, of 1987. And he celebrated his birthday today with a two-for-four night. But the victory goes to Texas, 6-5. Ryan gets the win. He's 3-0. Gutterman takes the loss, and Russell gets the save. That's it from Arlington Stadium. Our next Yankee telecast will be tomorrow night at 8:30 as the Yankees will face these same Texas Rangers here on the Yankee Baseball Network. Coming on next on WPIX Channel 11 is the Honeymooners and Hill Street Blues. Final score again, the Rangers 6, the Yankees 5. For the Scooter, Phil Rizzuto, and for Tom Seaver, and for our entire crew in Arlington and at WPIX, this is George Grand. Good night, everybody.